activate it in our lives. God gives us faith, but we have the choice of picking up that shield of faith and using it to guard us against the enemy. When we put it into action, no fiery dart of the enemy can penetrate the shield of faith. 1 John 5 and verse 4 says, "This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith." Now, a shield is different from all the other parts of the armor in that it can be moved about to protect the most vulnerable parts of attack. It will be there when it's needed. It'll be where it's needed. And if you use it, it'll be available when it's needed. I don't know if I'm going to get to that. Or anyway, we're going to try. There's a song by Alison Krauss that wrote, "Sometimes I'm battle-weary, I forget to use my shield. The arrows pierce my armor, and I stumble in the field. A shield won't do much good if it's hanging by your side. Keep the shield of faith before you if you want to stay alive. I'll think my life is over, but the Lord, He comes to me. He heals my wounded spirit, and He sets me on my feet. A shield won't do much good if it's hanging by your side, so keep the shield of faith before you if you want to stay alive. Sometimes you're battle weary, but the war's already won. Keep your head up high and hold your shield high till your days of life are done."
You was that?
Alison Krauss, K-R-A-U-S-S. The helmet of salvation. The head is set, is the seat of the mind, sorry. The head is the seat of the mind, and the mind controls the actions of the mind. Of our body. It controls our actions. It is where Satan attacks us the most, is in our mind and our thoughts, because it makes us doubt ourselves. He seeks to control our thoughts, and he seeks to confuse us with false doctrines and vain philosophies. Hence we are told in 1 Peter 1 and 13 to gird up the loins of our mind. In Ephesians 4 and 23, it says, "Be renewed in the spirit of your mind." Our mind is to be covered and protected by the helmet of salvation. The soldiers must be in control by the master, the helmet of salvation, which is Jesus Christ. And when our minds are set on Jesus, we can cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of Christ. We have to keep our minds on Jesus. When the enemy attacks our minds with false religions and false philosophies and doubts and fears, we can fight back. Without doing anything, we can fight back with all the things that God has equipped us with and say, "You are a liar and the father of lies, and I am not like that, and I don't believe that. And Jesus has changed me. I plead the blood of Jesus." The sword of the Spirit. This is the word of God. This is an offensive weapon. We must sharpen our spiritual sword and learn to wield it properly, for it is the most effective. For the word of God is quick, and it's powerful, and it's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of the soul and the spirit and the joints and the marrows, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of our heart. Hebrews 4, verse 12. The sword is two-edged and can bring you great victory, or it can bring you ultimate defeat. if we are studying the Word of God and filling our hearts with the Word of God, it will convict us. It will change us. It'll change our outlook. It'll strengthen our faith. So learn to take the Word of God and to use it properly. Learn to sharpen it to fight your greatest adversary. It's what Jesus used in the mountain. He used the Word of God. And we are to use the Word of God to fight the adversary. You can live in victory. Put on the whole armor of God. The epistles, now this is a previous statement I've made before, but it bears repeating, are letters written to the churches. People already baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. The epistles were written to instruct born-again Christians how to live, how to worship. It was written so that we would learn church discipline and how to develop the fruits of the Spirit and to weld our weaponry with wisdom. That's Ephesians. I'm going to move on quickly to Philippians, and we'll try and get through it really quick. And then if you have any questions, please feel free to ask me, okay? The book of Philippians. Philippians 1 and verse 1 identifies Paul as the author, which we know. It was written afterwards, sorry. In AD 61. Paul was a prisoner of Nero in Rome at the time, so he was a prisoner again. Silas, Timothy, Luke, and Paul visited Philippi 11 years before Paul wrote this letter. Their first visit was in AD 51. It was at Philippi which the apostle visited on his second missionary journey that Lydia and the Philippian jailer and his family were converted. Acts 16, verse 12. In AD 51. Yeah, and I don't have a date on that, but it just refers to his second visit where Lydia and the Philippian jailer, do you remember the story of the Philippian jailer? The church of Philippi is the first to be founded in Europe. Details of the birth of the Philippian church is found in Acts chapter 16. The apostle Paul had planned to go to Asia, but the Spirit forbade him to go. But eventually, you know, he got there, right? Because they said that Paul's message was being preached all over Asia. But eventually he got there. But Paul didn't get to Asia right away. Paul saw a man from Macedonia in a vision. And that man was standing there and he was praying, come over into Macedonia and help us. As this open door was made available for them, they traveled to Philippi without delay. And so when they get into Philippi, they must have found some kind of lodging or something. And on the Sabbath day, which was Paul's habit, they made their way to the river where they had heard of some women. Some what? But what did Paul see? He seen a man in Macedonia crying out to come and help us, but it was some women that were gathered there to pray. The first European convert was a woman by the name of Lydia. She was a seller of purple, and obviously she was pretty wealthy And she was a great hostess and invited the apostles Paul to live or abide at her house for a while. Later on, as Paul is in Philippi, he meets a damsel possessed with evil spirits. And the spirits were cast out and she followed the apostles. But as a result of this, Paul and Silas were cast into prison. Sometimes God takes us on a journey that doesn't always look appealing, but it brings us to the place where he really wants us to be. Here we find the story of the jailer and his family. He would never have met this jailer had he not been cast into prison. And how they were saved. And you find this all in Acts chapter 16. The key words found in Philippians are joy and rejoicing. It's mentioned 17 times in 4 chapters. Although Paul wrote this letter from prison, it is said to be one of his happiest letters. Who ever heard of somebody being happy in prison? Obviously, Paul was. Paul instructs the Philippians to rejoice. Rejoice in prayer. 1 verse 4. Rejoice in the gospel. 1 verse 18. Rejoiced in Christian fellowship or godly fellowship. Chapter 2, verses 1 through 1 and 2. You don't really have to write all these down unless you want to. Rejoice in sacrifice for the cause. Rejoice when you suffer for his name's sake. Chapter 2, verses 17 and 18. Rejoice in the Lord. Chapter 3, verse 1. Rejoice in the loving care of the church. Chapter 4, verse 10. In Philippians 1 and verse 21, this is a key verse that you might have to remember of where it's found. For to me, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. And you can say that being in prison. He never knew when he was going to die. Philippians 3 and verse 7 says, but whatever was to my profit, I now consider for loss for the sake of Christ. I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. Philippians 4 and verse 4, rejoice. I like this one. In the Lord. Always, and again, I say rejoice. We made a song out of that. Philippians 4, verses 6 through 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Last verse that I want to read for a little while. Philippians 4 and verse 13. I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Or I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. The central concept or theme of this letter is, for me to live is Christ, but for me to die is gain. It's reiterated in two verses, verse 5 of chapter 3 and verse 8 of chapter 4 and verse 13. The book is divided up into four chapters. And in chapter 1, Paul talks about the joy of living. There's four chapters in Philippians, and in chapter one, it's the joy of living. And in chapter two, it's the joy in service. And in chapter three, it's the joy in fellowship. And in chapter four, the joy in rewards. Moving on. In chapter 3, Paul talks about Christ being the object of our affection, that I may win Christ, he said. And then he says, or that I might be found in him. So these are, let me refer back here so you guys can catch it. Chapter 3, verses 8, right on through verse 10. Right through to verse 14. He says that I might be found in Christ, that I might know him. If you just write down chapter 3, verses 8 through 14, yeah, okay, then you can get all this. That I might know the power of his resurrection, that I might know the fellowship of his suffering, that I may be apprehended, and that I may press towards the mark of my high calling, which is in Christ Jesus. Paul knew that he could not be made perfect in this flesh, but so he endeavored to press towards that mark that he found in Christ Jesus. He knew that who he was only because of God. And so that was his goal. In chapter 4, verses 8, he encourages us to think on some things. And this is where we're going to dwell for the next little bit. So think on these things. If you want to write these down, you can. True, whatsoever things are true. Whatsoever things are honest. I do believe this question is on your exams. You might want to write that. Whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, pure, lovely, and a good report. Seems like some good things to think about. Paul goes on to say, if there be any virtue, or if there be any praise, think on these things. What do all these things mean? To be true means to be real. Think on the things that are real and genuine and authentic. To be honest means to be honorable in principles, in intention, and then in your actions. Seems we'll get to use that word quite a bit today, Sister Sabrina, about being intentional. To be pure means to be found free without blemish, clean, spotless, and unsullied. And we all know that we can't be that way without Jesus Christ. To be just means to be guided by truth, to be guided by reason and justice according to principle. Where do we find these principles? In the Word of God. To be lovely means to be delightful, of great moral or spiritual beauty. To not only say that you're godly, but have somebody else come up to you and say, there's something different about you. You're glowing. You are beautiful in God's eyes. It doesn't matter what the world thinks you are. It matters what God thinks we are. Good report means a high quality statement. It means that people have good things to say about you. He's a man of integrity. You can trust his word. I would I would put my life in his hands because I can trust him. Good report. He's a godly man. He's a righteous man. Look how he walks. Good report. Virtue means moral and ethical principles of righteousness. Means to have the right morality. Have God living in you that gives you these ethical principles of righteousness. You cannot have it unless you're willing to put yourself in the Word of God and allow it to work in your life. That's how you'll get your righteousness. That's how you'll get your principles. It's in the Word of God. Praise is worship. And Paul said, at the end of it, he said, if there be any virtue, or if there be any praise, think on these things. Let our worship be on the things that are good and honest and right and godly. Paul appeals to the Philippians for three things. To have the mind of Christ, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. To have the knowledge of Christ, chapter 3, verse 1. And to have the peace of Christ, chapter 4, verse 13. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. Paul ends this joyous letter by letting them know wherein lies his strength. It is in Christ and Christ alone. And that is where your strength is also. So if I end it today, know where your strength lies. Everything we are is in Christ. Everything we do is in Christ. And where is our strength? In Christ. Thank you. Any questions?